One.
Nithyanandam, yesterday on 7th December 2017, a very important judgment was passed by the Supreme Court of India. It was on a case, a false rape case, and filed by a guy. That is a weird part. It was filed based on a complaint by a guy who is nowhere an affected party. Anyhow, that rape case has been going on since almost 7 years. So, and it got escalated all the way to the Supreme Court because the case was not moving at all. So finally, the Supreme Court yesterday made a judgment. They said that they ordered that all the evidences which were suppressed, all the evidences in favor of my Guru Paramahansa Nithyananda which were suppressed, they should be brought forward because the whole investigation was completely unfair and all the evidences were wantingly suppressed. This is a very, 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 very big statement to come from the apex court of the country. The court of the country is saying the trial which happened so far was unfair and the evidences were suppressed willfully by the other parties. So, I'll run through the evidences which are being presented in the court eventually, which will be presented, and I will also give you a background of what the case is about. Before jumping into that, I want to mention one news which came a couple of days ago. There was a false rape case filed on a guy and they found out the price at which the woman, the lady had filed the false rape case, that was only rupees 20,000. For the benefit of people from other countries, rupees 20,000, I can say it is around $300. A little bit more than, you can say, $330. So, as Calvin said, that it's not, I don't know what is more sad, that everybody has a price or that the price is so low. Now, coming to the background of the case itself, a brief run over the whole story. In 2010, a morphed video came which had got nothing based on what you can say a rape happened or could have happened in the future or had happened in the past, based on a morphed video which had got nothing really big, someone filed a rape case, and that too a guy, against my Guru Paramahansa Nithyananda, and he was arrested without a rape victim and kept in prison illegally. Of course, the Supreme Court of India had to say that the arrest was illegal. But, okay, it's like a joke that the Supreme Court of India had to say the arrest was illegal. That too after 6 or 7 years. Anyhow, after 8 months or, you know, around that time, a person came up and said, okay, I am the witness. See, she's not saying I am the victim. She's saying I am the witness. I only recorded the video and so what's the big deal about it? So, okay, she has to build up more story. I was actually raped also. Okay, when were you raped? I was raped on this date. Oh no, I was raped on this date. So she kept on changing the dates. Finally, whatever dates she said, we have a few evidences which does not explain, does not work out. She's telling a certain date when she was raped, and on that same date, she was in US going through a medical examination for 4 STDs which she has. And Swamiji was in India. How can a rape happen? And by the way, the medical examination which she was having was for 4 incurable sexually transmitted diseases, which it is impossible that will not be transferred to the other person if there is any kind of even skin to skin contact. In fact, she is so contagious that in one of the incidences, she was casually touching her lip and was going to shake her hands with the doctor, and the doctor was afraid that he will catch the disease, so he said, don't touch me. She's that deadly. Even like saliva or skin to skin contact is enough to spread, and she's telling she was raped 50 times, which is like a completely impossible, medically untenable, ridiculous kind of argument. Again, she made a claim that she was raped in 2005, and now what it is, 2017. That day, again she was in US, she's telling rape happened in Bangalore, and Swamiji happened to be in Salem. Because, and there were like so many witnesses, and there's a video and, you know, coverage in the local newspapers. What more can you ask for? All these evidences were suppressed. Furthermore, there was the video itself. See, the video itself has nothing which, as I already said, which based on what you can say a rape is happening, will happen or had happened. There was really nothing in the video. Anyhow, the video itself is mocked, has been proven by four forensic agencies employed by FBI and countries throughout the world. It's not like just US or Canada or UK or India or Sri Lanka. All these countries hire these experts. India has hired these experts. And they found out and they concluded, they gave 60 reasons why the video is mocked, which is not a joke. 60 reasons is like huge. That evidence, the court has said, we can present. Similarly, the four STDs which she has, it dates back to the time when she was in university. That was Bits Pilani. And she was an engineering student that time. And see, one thing, just a thought which came, so I'm sharing with you. If you catch one STD, one sexually transmitted disease, okay, you can say that something might have happened which is not under your control. Nothing to do with your character or anything. Two, still I can say, how about four? What kind of a lifestyle you have during your study period in a university? How can a homely, you know, person, girl, can catch four STDs when she is in a university supposed to study engineering? So it dates back from there to now. And also another point, that those diseases are incurable. So it is like very clear that if there has been any kind of any kind of even skin to skin contact or saliva touch, you're gonna mess up. So she's a very dangerous person to even do a handshake. It goes to that extent. So there are a bunch of other evidences like that. One more. So one of the days when she said she was raped, her husband had actually come to India along with her and taking blessings of Swamiji. So you might be wondering, why Swamiji didn't do anything? He didn't understand or what? Why was he like allowing such people? See, basically, I don't know the reason but I know one thing, he gives a chance to everybody. So we were having a discussion one day that a person who was into drugs some time ago, he wants to become an Adinavasi. Swamiji just said one thing, it's not that we are going, the thing, has he agreed and decided that he is not going to go into all these activities, then we should give him a chance. So Swamiji gives a chance to everybody. Sadashiva is Sadashiva for everybody. Whether you are a Bhuta, Vishacha, Gandharva, anybody. For everybody is Sadashiva, so he gives everybody a chance. So they lost their chance. So he does not judge anybody. Coming back, so the day when she's taking blessings from Swamiji along with her husband, she's telling she was raped. And like, okay. Then she used to write many letters saying that she connects with Swamiji as mother of Swamiji. And she would address a gathering and call people, and was a co-author for a book which says, my son, I don't remember the title. It was like being mother of God, something like that. So she actually wrote lots of poems saying that she connects with Swamiji as his, as a mother and all those things. It's like, if you see it in retrospect, that time you would not understand because nothing happened. It's like so cheap, dirty, ugly. And on the other hand, the way she is describing and lying in the courts, if you see the whole case, actually nobody buys the argument of the false rape. Nobody buys. Anywhere, anybody in the entire planet, whoever knows anything about it, they do not believe even 1% in the rape case, in the false rape case. Nobody talks about it. So that matter has actually already become redundant. But people are still questioning, oh, maybe that video is real. So now, okay, so what? A video is there. Based on that, what will you do? A person is there in a video or not there in a video. Based on that, can you have any inquiry and waste 7 years of the judiciary's time? It's a ridiculous thing. You register a rape case without a rape victim. It's a complete abuse of the judicial system of the country. And by the way, the conspirators on the whole thing, they got fined around 10 crore rupees. If I have to tell you in USD terms, it's almost $2 million, US dollars. Almost that much they have been fined. And in spite of that, it's just going on. But I think the time has come. It's going to end. But one more important thing I want to share with you guys. This is not the end of the struggles and the struggles that we as an organization may be facing. The nature of it might vary because there are so many anti-Hindu forces in the country. Unless and until they are here, this battle is going to go on. The form might change because recently, I can say 3 months ago, we were setting up a Gurukul in Trishula Madinam, it's around Chennai. And there was a huge attack on sannyasinis, female monks, where there was attempt to rape and attempt to murder. And people and sannyasis were attacked. Finally, the police came and had to arrest almost around 200 people. So things like that will continue, might continue. I am not saying that it should continue. But in spite of that, we are going to do our job. This cannot stop the purpose of why Swamiji happened on this planet Earth, which is to revive Vedic Sanatana Hindu Dharma. And this is life for us. So if there is any threat to your life, naturally you are going to stand. So thank you for watching. Nithyananda.